Hey, well, welcome to One Million Cups Colorado Springs. We're so excited to have you here today. You, whether you know it or not, are joining a community of over, what is it, 2,000, 7,000 people?
Something like that, in between there.
Across the nation, 70 other cities at 9 o'clock right now are doing the same thing you guys are doing. And what is it that we're doing? Good question, glad you asked. If you're here today, what you're going to see is we have two presenters. Each gets 6 minutes to present, 20 minutes of Q&A. In the middle, we'll have time for some community announcements. And that's basically the role of things. But first off, before we get started, we have to do a special announcement because we have a coffee sponsor, Score. So tell us more.
So we don't have our little... whatever you call it,
logo
and everything. But we do have these. These tell us our expertise, all the expertise of our members. If you're not sure what Score does, we are a free mentoring service for small businesses. We'd love to talk with you at the beginning of your business and throughout your business. And when I say we want to talk with you, I'm not talking about the person on either side of you. I'm talking about you. We would really like the opportunity to sit down and help you develop your business. And enjoy the coffee.
Woo! Thank you! All right, cool. Well, now we're caffeinated and we're ready to go. I'd like to introduce our first presenter, Sol, with Urban Cyclery. There you go.
Good morning, everybody. As you mentioned, my name is Sol, real name is Steven Cedric. Don't call me that. Just call me Sol. You see me, you say, what's up, Sol? I'm an artist, a foodie, mechanic, entrepreneur, just a couple little titles I have. I'm originally from New York, by way of California. Yeah, I know, right? Everybody's a transplant. No one's from here. So, quick story. As a kid, I loved bikes, sneakers, art, a lot of sneakers, and this leads me into why I moved to California. I went to CSULB, Long Beach State, where I got my BFA in art, specializing in drawing and painting. There's a reason why we call it starving artist, so I had to get a real job real quick after college. One of them was where I worked for Enterprise, so they kind of taught me, they recruit you right out of college, so they teach you how to be kind of like your own boss from the, really quickly. It wasn't a great job, but this will lead you into the story of how I got my name. Got home one day after work, laid at the foot of his bed, and he was jumping on his bed like little kids do. Fell off his bed, landed perfectly on my head, and he popped out two discs in my head. So I was paralyzed. Not paralyzed, but I couldn't lift my head off my chest for about 2.5-3 months. So that was awesome. So I lost my job. I lost all of the income we had. He was like just one, and everything was going pretty bad. And one day my brothers in New York were outside of a sneaker shop, and they were like, well, why don't you put a shoe on your chest and paint with a brush in your mouth, being super sarcastic. But I took it to heart, and I did it. This little thing. I painted my first shoe, I put it online, and boom, Soul Junkie was born. So I was a custom sneaker artist, hence the name Soul. I've been fascinated with shoes for a long time. Art, and it's gonna translate into bikes in a second. And I've actually customized stuff from a lot of athletes and artists. Tucker Tuzzi, hockey player, Tori Hunter, Dwight Howard. I did stuff for like Pepsi, Sprite, Colt 45. Worked with a lot of companies. I have a published book, been in a bunch of magazines, domestically and internationally. None of you guys know that. So, so at this point in time, I was doing pretty good. I actually got rehabilitated and everything, and I could ship my art anywhere, so wife and mine moved down to San Diego. And that's about the time for the the economy kind of crashed. So I had to get another real job. It sucked, which led me to a law firm that I had worked down there. Small little law firm that brought down Enron, RGRD. They've changed a bunch of names since. They are securities litigation, and I was fortunate to get a job doing marketing, graphics, PowerPoints, demonstratives. But then I got tired of big corporate America, and I was a big preacher about, hey, follow your dreams and better your life. So we're in the mountains now. So we moved out here, cash out. First store we opened up on our journey to be business owners was a kids consignment shop. So my wife had a shop on Bijou, and it was open for about 2 years. And while I was there, I wanted to do my own thing. I really wanted a bike shop, and the opportunity came up a couple doors down. Boom, it was like it was born. So I took a chance, bought a little bike shop, and here it is. My bike shop is super affordable. I mean, my bikes, I've actually sold a couple of bikes to a couple of people here. So I can see about two or three. And it's full service. We have parts, accessories, all that stuff. But what sets me apart is I translate my art into the bikes, customizing bikes. You guys get a chance to come see them. I try to focus on single speeds and fixies, but we do everything else. We have mountain bikes, we have commuters, we have road bikes. We're probably the newest, smallest, but I think the coolest shop in town. I'm just saying. If you've been in my shop, you know. You know. But we do a bunch of cool stuff down there. Like I said, I love art and bikes, and there's plenty of that here already. I'm just trying to bridge the gap. Trying to bring that together down here or add to what you guys already have going. I think Colorado Springs is a beautiful clean slate to kind of build up even more culture and have more fun things to do. And I just want to be part of that. Some of the events we have is like art nights, like on First Fridays. We empty out the store. We have a thing called Art Cycle. Just come in, just paint. Paint, drink, listen to music. Or don't drink. Whichever board helps you. But we do Wednesday night rides. We tried to join up and down a couple times. And turns out some of the guys that we have want to go a little faster. So we do our own little thing. What else we got? And this Friday we're doing a Halloween costume ride. So if you get a chance, come join us.
Good job. All right, time for Q&A.
You don't handle it.
So do you paint just any part of whatever the customer wants? From the scenes I see to some of the frame?
I can, yeah. It's just, it's what, I always say it's up to what your wallet lets you do.
Okay. And did somebody bring in those shoes as inspiration for that one?
I did. I actually painted those shoes too.
Okay, cool.
So I painted the shoes and the bike to match. You got that?
Yes. First of all, thanks for jumping in on short notice. You know, let's all give Sol a What made you choose Colorado Springs?
My wife has family here.
Okay.
So she's always wanted to come out here and live here for a while. It's really beautiful here. I mean, I don't like the snow, but everybody else does. It's a democracy in my house, and I got it. Yeah, so I'm here, but we live right downtown. It's really nice, and so we're here, and I'm loving it. I have a little love hate. I'm a city kid, so.
How long have you been open, and what's your vision for Urban
Cyclery
as you grow?
A bunch of things I want to do. Whether it happen or not, we'll see. But we've been open for about almost a year and a half. So this will be our second winter. And vision is, actually we talked about this the other day. I kind of want to start getting my bikes to businesses, like customizing bikes for them, putting their logos on it. Maybe having them or their employees have something to ride. mean, they're pretty inexpensive, a couple hundred bucks. I mean, it's the cost of one of you guys' forks here. The guys are real bikes. So, you know, it's just something to get people out and active.
First of all, I love my bike. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
What's been the biggest challenge in the first year and a half, and how did you work through it?
Winter.
Winter sucks.
I basically literally sat, twiddled my thumbs, and I painted a lot during winter. No one came in. So it's just more of getting people to know I'm there. And they always say, oh, you're always closed. Like, well, you gotta come during store hours. Key part. But winter's hard because you don't really ride. Bikes are meant for the roads. So that's pretty much it. People who come in during winter. And this winter, I think we're gonna do, maybe not so much for profit, but just come in and have movie nights. Get a couple bean bags, a couple drinks. Throw up a projector, just hang out. My shop is a hangout. Like, yeah, it gets bad sometimes.
Have you thought about doing any winter sports options?
I did. I'm not knowledgeable in winter sports. I snowboarded once and I headbutted the whole side of the mountain. I'm good. I'll stop that. Yes, sir.
For the winter months, have you thought about partnering with somebody like Switchback Coffee or something and serving coffee for when people are hanging out so you have a little bit of cash flow during the winter months?
I haven't, but I'm up to it. But then again, across the street, I'm right across the street from Story Coffee, and on the left side is Starbucks, and then every single restaurant in town has coffee and baristas. I'm just too lucky to be.
Yes.
So I know that winter months are challenging when you're in the sports industry here. But do you do any e-commerce, or do you sell some of your customized parts to, like, you know, break them down and send them out and that kind of thing?
So that, which I tried, and that I think the parts are fairly inexpensive. The bikes are fairly inexpensive, like entry to mid-level bikes, and the shipping and the packaging and all that stuff add so much exponentially onto that people are like, nah, we're good. I've only shipped one bike. To Texas, but after that, the money they saved, they paid in shipping. So I'm not gonna need that. There's low margins on bikes, so that kind of like good. Yes, miss.
So, what is your desired customer base, and how do you reach out to them?
Everybody. I'm word of mouth. I do social media a lot, which is working out for me. I actually got inquiries from like England, Germany, and stuff like that, which is kind of weird. Like, yeah, but it was more of asking like, how do I paint this, or how do I do this to my bike? You know, not so much send me a bike. They have nice bikes out there too. But I'm trying to work on the marketing side of that, because again, the budget's not there yet. So I'm trying to save my what little money I have for the winter months to come. Yes, sir.
What do you? What's more of your long term? Is this a scalable possibility from a finance aspect?
I think so. I want to be so. I want to hire more people. I want to train kids and like I'm trying to pitch to launch, go train kids how to work on bikes and build bikes and stuff like that. So long term goal is to get another shop, hire people, give somebody something to do. Some income and keep it going. Hopefully branch out like again to bigger companies where they can have a fleet of bikes. Guys don't have to like drive their cars to lunch.
Right. So is there what are your needs now financially?
I just gotta get to winning first. This is it. This is like Game of Thrones, winter is coming. I'm just saying.
Fixies are a niche market.
Yeah.
Do you think you could sell to people all over the country because of the, you know, but painting, take the part that isn't that expensive, and then, but your art is worth a lot, therefore covering shipping. Have you done that, or have you thought about that?
Still working on it.
The next question is,
I'm into bikes, not fixies.
Yeah.
Do people who are into fixies have the cash, or are they dedicated enough to spend significant money to get something that makes it theirs? Or is it too dangerous a market? A lot of delivery people use them. Are they afraid that, you know, is there a possibility that it just gets stolen?
Man, Andrew just stole here. They'll cut through lots of hot knives to butter. In regards to the fixie market, there are some really expensive bikes. Fixies can get up to a couple grand, and especially when you get to stuff like this, like for the Velo, you know, you're looking at carbon fiber weight, stuff like that, so you're looking at 4 or 5 Gs, you know, just to get the weight of like 14 pounds, which is like their specs. But it just depends on the rider, if they have the money or not. There's some people who invest, and I don't know, I'm looking forward to seeing what can be done. You know, fixies, right now, there's fixie riders everywhere across, not just delivery riders, but it's really fun, it's really hard. But in regards to if it'll take off and it'll be niche, that's just the same as like cycling. Can the guy afford a carbon bike and stuff like that? So I don't know if I answered that correctly, but there's possibility. And it's really good for roadies to jump on fixies or single speeds. You get stronger quicker. I've raced a couple roadies, and I keep telling them, use your gears. So we'll see. Yes, miss.
Is it possible to monetize your art by making them decals that could be applied to the two that you have there? The more popular versions, where people could buy that and apply it to their fixie?
I don't know about in regards to that. That gets into like manufacturing. If I would be a graphic or something like that, you can wrap a bike in, perhaps. But that's something I haven't. Again, I don't have the capital to even start looking and stuff like that. So, next time. I'm saving up to it though. Baby steps.
Made part of the vision.
Yes. I'll add it to the list. Yes, sir.
You got a pretty cool story leading up to this newest business. But what? I'm curious, what book did you write?
It's actually called Soul Junkie. It's a coffee table book about my shoe art. You see it on Amazon. It's probably like the latest thing on it. Didn't do too good. We didn't have a marketing budget for that either. But it's not self-published. I actually had a publisher. It was a Transit Creative. They reached out to me after I did a couple projects with them. They're like, hey, you want a book? I'm like, yeah.
Why did you leave the shoe market?
It got pretty saturated. And then, again, that was a time where knowing that the market crashed pretty bad. And I had to dedicate myself to like a real job. I was already considered unhirable. So no one really had extra money to spend. Like, because shoes for me, like when I sell them, for example, these are Jordans, I'll just give you a quick nerd thing about shoes. So those Jordans, they retail for about $200, but as soon as they release, there's people who flip them and they start selling for $400. Add the artwork on there for like another $300. It's a $700 to $800 shoe. Yes,
yeah.
There's a shoe market. Yeah, like Kanye West shoes sell out in seconds. They sell for like $350, and as soon as they sell, somebody puts them on eBay for like $4,000, and they sell. And I'm stuck at home. Why not me?
I just think part of what's going for you is the customization of your bikes, but you know, like I really like the idea of matching your shoes to your bike, to your hat, to your, you know, whatever. Like, have you considered opening up the customization a little bit more to other products?
Yeah, once I get there. Long-term goals. That's the 5 to 10 year plan. Right now.
What's that short-term goals?
Huh?
Sorry, this is relevant.
I'm 11.
You're 11? What if you sold shoes in the wintertime?
We thought about that. But there's people don't really
running shoes that time. They're not like fashion shoes.
Right, and so the ones, right. There's not really big base here. It's big in Denver. The only people that would actually keep that going would be the military, because they come from more shoe culture, urban styles. I mean, it's not shoe culture. It's not just urban, but Yeah, there's one lady in town, her name is Chris from Pens and Needles. She beat me. I cut down, I'm down to like 200 pairs, and she has 700. She has like, hashtag goals. I act up when I walk into a shoe store. So, be all hot and sweaty, jittery, I find those.
Anybody else?
Yes.
What's the address of your shop?
109 East Bijou. I'm in between King Chef and Subway. Right across the street from Acacia, behind Bad Shop. The only bike shop on the beach. It's tiny though, if you blink you miss it. But you probably won't miss it because probably a bunch of people in here laughing and having a if you ever walk in on any given day, like especially like a Saturday or the weekends, we're posted up on the steps. We're having a good time. Yes, sir.
So how do any of us get involved like with your events? Like where would you recommend us going to find more info about that?
I always post up on Instagram. Everything's the same. If you wanted to stalk me, it's pretty easy. I made it easy. Everything's at the Urban Cyclery. Twitter, Instagram, the Urban Cyclery. Facebook, the Urban Cyclery. My Gmail, the Urban Cyclery. The store, the Urban Cyclery. So it's not hard. I made it pretty easy across the board to get a hold. And I post my events there and anything that comes up. And even rides, like impromptu rides or paint nights. I said, who wants to paint? Boom, we'll be there like midnight to like 3 a.m, just painting, hanging out. So if everything's on there, that's the only way I found that's been successful for me so far.
Yes. What events do you have?
The one coming up Friday is a costume ride. You know, it's free. Just dress up, bring a bike. We'll ride around downtown, scare people, annoy people, take up the streets, and then we're gonna go back to the shop. Pizza, drinks, music, and some Nintendo. Here's some beer pong.
Beer?
Yeah, it gets weird. So I invite you all if you're bored. And it's from like 6:30 to 10, so it doesn't cut your, doesn't go too long into the evening unless you want to. Just come by, say hi, that's it. Yes?
Do you partner with any bike clubs or anything like that?
Not yet. I'm frowned upon. I'm flashy. I got fixies. They got gears. So we don't wear kits.
Up and down though.
Up and down, yeah. They've been pretty cool. I've talked to Al Moshan, Sarah Kelso, all the people involved there, but it's getting to show up is the hard part. The city's pretty divided. People on the east side stay there, University of Philly stay there, Old Colorado stays there, and downtown kind of. So it's just getting more people to get involved. Because I hate hearing, oh, there's nothing to do. Dude, we've been throwing parties for like the last 4 months. It's true.
So we have 300 days of sunshine.
Yes.
Snow melts fast.
Yes.
Is there any way during the winter time that you can make your tires a little bit wider?
I still have tires.
Okay.
So I got those.
You can make this go through snow. You might maybe make some events around, you know.
Yeah. I might get a bunch of fleet, like fat tire bikes, rent them out, just get drunk on trail.
Yeah.
It's these dumb ideas that got me this far. Work. So I'm gonna continue riding and holding. Tonight we're gonna ride too, as much as possible.
We got the Greenway Trail, so you can't get too much of a DUI on that, right?
Yeah, awesome. You only get DUI when you get caught.
to tag onto that, I mean, ice biking is a thing.
Isn't it?
Ice bikes and ice bikes tend to be fixed.
Yeah, I've seen them. I've seen them on the tires.
Yeah, I mean, it seems like that's kind of an extreme sport. There tends to be a, I don't know, kind of a link between a kind of extreme sport and art.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if there might be a correlation there, because that's, I mean, that's definitely.
I've never looked into that, nor, but you know, that's something to look into. The only issue I have, like, right now is my store is tiny.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like, this is the front, that's the back. It's 600 square feet.
Right, left.
Like, if you sneeze, I passed, and you passed the counter. So it's, but it's cool. It's my shop. It's, I don't know, I think it's fine. But yeah, that would be something I could look into. Again, when I get the opportunity to expand, man, everything. I have every single bike in the world in there. If I could, but I can't.
This is the big one. Who would like to ask our final and special question? It's very special.
So, what can we as a community in Colorado Springs do to support you?
Thank you for asking, and thank you for buying a bike. Seriously, I thank you for coming to me. There's a bunch of bike shops in town. Just get involved. Come by, say hi, spread the word. You don't have to like my bikes. You don't have to buy some. But if you can at least refer me to somebody, just keep my doors open and let this grow and continue, and I can help maybe help somebody provide for their future one day. That'd be awesome. Just get involved, hang out, come say hello.
Awesome. You will get a 1 million cups bike. Awesome. All right. Well, while our next presenter is setting up, there's restrooms over that way, more coffee over that way, and right in here, we're going to do some community announcements. So, what are our community announcements? They are not My Business Sells X by X. It is, I have an awesome event. I want to tell you about it. It's good for the community. So, without further ado, any community announcements? Yes, Jill.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. My name is Jill. This is Andy. We're with the Innovation Program at Carter College. Two events to make you aware of if you're interested. Short notice, but today at 4 on campus, we're featuring the Colorado Coalition for Social Impact. Many of you might already be familiar with them. They presented at CUPS in August. They're coming in to present about their progress, where they're at with everything, and what the future holds for them. So if you want to know more, want to come at 4 today to see me after. Number two, next Thursday, November 3rd at 7 p.m., also at Carter College, we are bringing in a speaker who is an award-winning documentary filmmaker, writer, and poet, who's going to talk about her creative process and how you impact social change through creativity. So 7 o'clock, November 3rd, I'll be back the next Wednesday to remind you. Any questions, please see me after.
Awesome. Thanks, Jill. All right. Anybody else? Sam, what up?
Startup Weekend is happening November 11th through the 13th. It is almost here. This is single-handedly one of the best entrepreneurship events that happens. It's 54 hours build a company. We've had companies in the past go on to win $80,000. This year, I just got an update. We have prizes equivalent to almost $3,000, and these are prizes that are actually going to help the businesses move forward and actually become scalable and make a profit right here in Colorado Springs. If you have any questions, let me know. We're all over Facebook, online, we're everywhere. So.
Everywhere. And we'll post stuff on our social media, right? Where is he? Vicky, we'll post on social media, right?
Absolutely.
Thanks. Hey, I have a quick announcement. So November 2nd, this is for primarily students, but also anybody else interested, at 5 o'clock at Berger Hall at UCCS, we'll be hosting the Colorado Secretary of State as a keynote speaker to talk about staying in Colorado for entrepreneurship as well. We'll have panelists featuring Chris Frond, Peak Startup, Heidi Ganahl, who's a potential CU regent and founder of Camp Bow Wow. We'll be hosting Tom Dunning, Terry Bolt, Preston Hare, who's the CEO of LotSpot, a local student startup, as well as featuring a lot of student startups in that building. So if you're interested in free food, student entrepreneurship, we'd love to see you there. November 2nd, come on out and join us. It'll be a good time.
What time?
5 o'clock at Berger Hall, UCCS. And it's free, so good food. Anybody else, community announcements? What up?
This Saturday, 11 to 3 at the City Auditorium, there's a ski and snowboard expo going on. Monarch Mountain's putting it on. Gonna be a lot of local companies, Mountain Chalet, Mountain Equipment Recyclers, a bunch of the ski shops here in town. It's gonna be a lot of fun.
Sounds awesome. Cool. All right. Anybody else? Yeah.
Next Thursday, November 3rd, is the Colorado Springs Livable Communities Forum. Colorado Springs is now an age-friendly city.
through AARP and the World Health Organization. So next Thursday, if you want to learn more about what being age-friendly means and making our city livable for people of all ages, next Thursday, Pikes Peak Center, 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. Innovations in Aging is where you can learn more.
Cool. hey, so one thing that we like to do here is see who's new. So raise your hands if this is your first time at one of the Cups Colorado Springs. Raise them high. We want to get a good count. All right. Awesome. Well, thanks for coming, guys. Really appreciate you being here. We hope to see you around next week. Did you get that?
I did. Yeah. So
all right. Cooperation, teamwork. All right. So without further ado, our second but not unknown presenter, a frequent here at One Million Cups, Chris with Pikes Peak Makerspace. So let's hear it.
Thanks. I'm actually going to talk about a new spinoff from the Makerspace today called Traction Tractor. But yeah, you may have known me from other presentations like Pikes Peak Makerspace, my fourth time presenting at 1 Million Cups. I think I hold the record most, so let's see here. So, like I said, this is a spinoff. The Pikes Peak Makerspace is literally just across the creek over here to the east. We're our close neighbor. Wow. One hit, it's ready to go. One of the questions we have when you ask this at the Makerspace is, why haven't you launched yet? Are you scared of something fairly unknown? Is it that time commitment you have up front? So keeping with that entrepreneur bug and support that we have at the Makerspace, kind of found out we're lacking in this neighborhood, in this community here. We're lacking a bit of a support system for what I'm going to talk about here, is specifically maybe the hobbyist or that guy with just a little bit of a product that's not quite ready to start that company yet. We're going to have that vehicle or that platform to help you launch and then test the market with your product. So I'm going to talk a little bit about that. So I kind of hashed this out quick. This is a presentation. So if you're at Startup Week, I presented this. Sorry, you're going to see the same thing again. But I hashed this out the night before and kind of looked at some of the steps that I went through with Motominded and the Makerspace, and kind of, wow, there's a lot going on there. You know, the Makerspace supports a few of these things already, but these are things you need to think about if you are going to start up your product-based company, something you want to sell online or some kind of touch and feel from. So it's pretty elaborate there. I mean, there's a lot of steps before you get going, but what we're hoping to do is kind of fast-track that. With my previous history with Motominded, that was one of the 1 Million Cups presentations I've had, which was Motominded was an idea on Friday, and I was selling by Monday, and sold my first product on Tuesday. So with that, I was lucky enough to have the resources. I knew how to draw in 3D. I happen to have a 3D printer at my house. So I was able to have those steps already in place to go this fast, but at the Makerspace already, we have those resources and those educational classes to help you do exactly what I did with Motominded right now. The thing that we're filling, kind of going to fill the gap with Traction Tractor is, I noticed starting my first nonprofit that I started was the Makerspace. As soon as we got board of directors and things like that, stuff slowed down big time. So we needed something to keep this process going fast. And with Traction Tractors, literally we set up a for-profit company. And like I said here, it's a lightning fast for-profit where we'd be helping launch more companies. Blah, 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 that's neat, but let's get into the nitty gritty of what I've kind of set up with the plan. We're helping those hobbyists get going. If you're starting up that product, that golden widget, and you're going to look for investors and go that route, maybe we can help you with that, but it's kind of not formed for that. It's more help that hobbyist who's been thinking about or already selling maybe online to help them get to that next level, get to that plateau. So we have that community members in place already at the Makerspace, and these are the things and the tools that we already have rolling now. So with this, we're kind of filling that gap. And here's a story. We have Ken Cordry, who's one of our members here. He's a great example. He's our first little test case going through with Traction Tractor. So Ken has, he's a retired teacher from Illinois. I'm slowing down. and he's already selling on Etsy and Facebook page a little bit, but he's dropped the Etsy store. He's fear of people copying what he's doing. So he walked into the makerspace with kind of no experience with laser cutting and things like that. He came into the makerspace, joined, and we quickly taught him how to use the laser cutter. Took one of our classes, Intro to Laser Cutting. So with that, he started making some neat little panels. He's now moved on to lampshades. His wife has got into it. She's selling little crafts, with earring crafts, things like that. And they're rolling right now, a little bit on our Facebook page, and they're hitting local markets, things like that. But it's just a little side hobby for them right now. They want to start really doing some supplemental income. So we're helping them do that. And so he is basically a product without a company. He wants to just keep selling at that point before he actually starts doing those tax returns, set up all that stuff, and get it rolling. So we're going to help him quick. So here's kind of the workflow. You know, he's joined the makerspace. He learned how to laser cut. He started making the panels. Now he has something to sell with the lampshades and things like that that he's making now. We've set up a Shopify store. So we love that. It's lightning fast. So really all we need for the member is a decent photograph, selling price, and a weight. And maybe a rough idea how what kind of box we're in. We're not doing the fulfillment yet. We're kind of letting the members do the fulfillment. But those are really the only things we need to launch it out. And we have a store category on our Facebook page. Soon the Shopify store is going to be its own separate animal soon. And that is kind of the simple workflow where we're at right now. We do take a cut, a small cut, a lot less than you're going to have to go somewhere else or sell wholesale, things like that. We're figuring out it's case by case basis on what product you have and what you're selling.
Awesome. All right. Questions, maybe about the workflow.
Sam.
I just want to applaud Chris because this is his fourth time. What's amazing about that is presenters are able to present every 6 months, and 1 million cups has only been around for 2 years. So that means that he has so much going on in this community that every 6 months he's been able to come back and tell us the new thing he's doing. So thank you, Chris.
Any other questions? I didn't finish.
Just so I understand, Traction Tractor runs under the umbrella of Makerspace. So you join Makerspace to participate in Traction Tractor?
Yes. Okay. Yes, you need to be a member of Makerspace to go through that. Yep. I apologize. This was pretty fast. We were asked to fill in last minute. I wasn't quite prepared, but hey, I'm ready to talk.
With your clients, how do you protect their intellectual property as they're going through this process, especially with your Shopify?
Yeah. Once you're on Shopify, it's an online web portal. It's a sales point. It's basically that way to take credit card payment, PayPal, things like that, really easy. If you're at that point, you're really not that worried about protecting that IP. You're actually wanting to want people to know about the company. As you're developing and building it online, the makerspace, we're a community workshop. There are folks that have they're working out their prototypes and they come in late at night and they're worried about everybody seeing it. But if you're really that worried, you got that golden widget, you're a patented, and go for the big investors, Makerspace is probably not in that space right now. No, we're not looking for you to be open source and tell all your secrets, but you're around, and it's a cool, neat community workshop. It's kind of like Epicentral's kind of got that software startup kind of base that they've formed over the years, and we kind of got that product startup thing. So we're always working out, pitching ideas. Say, hey, what's this problem? Could we solve it kind of thing? We're soon going to formalize and do some idea nights and actually try to do just like Startup Weekend, but a little less informal. Let's see if we can solve this problem with what we have here in the space already.
What kind of machines do you have? You mentioned laser cut, I assume CNC, mills, water jet.
Yeah. We have this for a bit. So we have... That helps me answer this like a question. So with it, we have maybe already been selling a little bit, but we already have mentors set up and ready to help you get launched to the next point. And as far as equipment, let me get ahead here quick. I have those slides here. So this is not an up-to-date list, but we have a full metal shop. We have a full wood shop. We have a laser cutter. We have a few 3D printers. we're right now building our CNC router table 4 foot by 8 foot by foot, kind of material handling. We have large format plotters printed on everything from banner to photo paper to fabric. Wire cutters, do decals, things like that. The list is growing all the time. We're turning down more donations than what we're taking, but it's pretty neat. We've already been here just about 4 months, and we're already kind of packed to the gills of our downtown location just over here, but our Manitou is rocking and rolling. We're getting ready to expand the metal shop and expand the wood shop. Downdraft, fume booth and Manitou. We have a full CNC machine, CNC lathe and Manitou as well.
So can you go back to your workflow and just sort of finish out what all you're doing with Traction Tractor since we asked you on such short notice?
Sorry, I can go through quick. So it's kind of once you get that you start selling with the Shopify store and the leads we have, he starts going to make more money. What do we do from here? We have those mentors in place to get you rolling and get out. So we also help you with, do you want to start a DBA? Do you want to start an LLC? How do you want to go with your next job and actually start that company? We help you get going when you're ready. And are you ready for retail? So we're going to have a little retail spot over there. We've already talked with Jake at Quad Innovation Partnership. They hope to soon have a little retail presence in their space below Loyal Coffee. Downtown Partnership has the pop-up stores. We can help you get connected with that. And if you want to go put on your big boy pants and go get a lease, we have those connections already. We already have a I Got a Guy network. That's about it.
So I've got a friend with a good idea of what he's trying to say. He has no idea about Pikes Peak space. Nothing. This is a new concept too. If I wanted to introduce him to you, what does the process look like? Does he have to get a trial membership to Pikes Peak space? A good little process. Is that how it works?
That's exactly it. So our membership base is kind of like a gym membership. So we do a month by month deal right now. So join for a month, kind of feel each other out. The first 30 days is like a trial thing. So you're able to stop at any time, or we might ask you to leave at any time. Right? Everybody's running for the maker spaces. So we have to come in, try it for a month, and then we go from there. And you kind of, after that 30 days, you kind of know if it's a fit or not, and we go.
So the membership has different layers or different levels of space that you have available?
Yeah. So our basic level is a student membership, 18 and older. If you're enrolled in some kind of educational institution here locally, it's $30 a month. Individuals just walking in the door is $55 a month, $75 a month for family. That's everybody under your household. And then we have dedicated desks as well. So those who might want to have a little spot to call our own, starts at about $175 a month. It goes from there. And that's kind of, we have two dedicated desks left in downtown, and we have one left in Manitou. We're already kind of, those were, before we even opened up the door, those we had half gone in downtown. We also have opportunities. Jill's here representing CC, so they've worked out a block of memberships. So if you're a Colorado College student, go through Jill, and she can get you through the channels, we get you trained, and CC pays for that membership, and they have a block of 12 right now here soon. So get it going. We're also in talks with the UCCS. We just enrolled two UCCS students joined recently. They didn't wait for UCCS to get their stuff together, but we're working out and getting it going. We're also talking with Pikes Peak Community College as well through the center.
So can you talk, now that everybody's heard you four times, talk about your vision around Pikes Peak Makerspace, the fact that it's a nonprofit, and now as you bring Traction Tractor in, what that whole vision is as you go forward?
Yeah, vision is just kind of keep that flow going and keep those folks that are pivoting or maybe have that idea or that product idea or something you want to launch. We want to support that all the way through. We want you to start and form that company, hire employees, stay here locally. I mean, that's the overall goal that we have with the makerspace. We have a whole mix of the makerspace, not just everybody walking in is not the newest, best, budding entrepreneur in there. We have basically one of our first members, Harry, is an old retired electrical engineer. He's hanging out just to help you out, answer questions, work on your projects. So it's a whole mix that we have in this network that we have at the makerspace already, from the hobbyist to just people who want to help out and hang out, to the students who come in and some don't even know what they want to do yet, but they're just learning about the equipment and to be ready if something happens or comes up later, they have that training and that equipment accessible there at the place. We even have members that have a lot of equipment we have at the makerspace come in and join the makerspace and just be around the community we have already. So I think the goal is just keep building this community, see how powerful and fast we can make it and do some big changes, things like that.
What does the training with Traction Tractor look like? Is it like little classes that people go to, or is it individual, or how do you progress someone through those steps?
We're still figuring out those. It's not a formal like workshop or program yet. It's more, hey, you know, Fred has come in, or in this case, Ken has come in, and we kind of listen to what are your challenges right now? He's like, I hate FC. You know, I got people copying what I'm doing. I need my own sales channel, but I don't know anything about e-commerce or things like that. And we're taking it organically because everybody's coming in with different challenges and different skills right now. There's one person I didn't get to show yet, but it's Drew, who does the circuit board ties. He's using the makerspace right now to create some of his complicated parts that he has for some of his high-end ties that he's working on. And we're also talking with how he's kind of challenged with he's got his own little e-commerce on the store, but there's other channels he'd like to sell. He'd like to have a little retail space on the weekends, so we're talking about that at the downtown location, maybe even at the Manitou location. There's front retail space there available too. So what Ken needs and what Drew needs is completely different with the resources. So we're just kind of treating it organically right now. You know, just kind of, it's really, really new. And we're just seeing how it goes. You know, it's neat that we already seen us on some of the slides. We've got that I Got a Guy network. If we don't have that equipment in the space or that maybe that talented person, we already know who they are and we already have the connections downtown. One thing even just water jet cutting. We don't have a water jet cutter yet, but Precision water jet off of Fillmore. Good friends of ours, if you got a complicated, we don't quite have that tool that needs for that cutting, we have that person that's already connected.
Are you familiar with Amazon's model of distribution, you know, and look at that as possible? Because that can be a very powerful,
yep,
extremely cost-effective way to get product out.
I think as we get more mature and maybe we outgrow Shopify, we're looking at AWS already with just their services with the web portal and things like that, that we can make our own custom stores, make it a little more, I could see it where, right now the Shopify stores, when it's popular at launch, it's gonna be a lot of categories. It's gonna be Ken stuff. It's gonna be a whole mix mash of stuff. But what's nice with Shopify is we can take these little modules and Ken can have set up a little Google website real quick and place those products and it just runs through the Shopify store. So we're already looking at the next steps to use not just AWS, but also how do we connect people to start selling on Amazon as well. So we're seeing that right now. Ken's not quite ready for that, so we're kind of using him as the test monkey to go through this stuff, but we're gonna see where that goes and see. Anytime we're looking and hearing all the opportunities, we got quite the network of folks that are like, hey, try Amazon, hey, let's go over here, try this. I've got tips on how to utilize web forums, web discussion forums a lot for really cheap and easy marketing, things like that. But we're trying to look in all directions.
Just curious, why the name Traction Tracker?
Just hit me one day. But one of the things is we're trying to do with that product idea is give it some traction, get it going. Tractor just kind of came because it was kind of makerspace-y, I guess. Kind of a little more their gear too. So. Not too much behind that one. Anything else? Kathy?
Talk to about somebody mentioned intellectual properties.
Yeah.
And talk about how many times you've seen somebody come in with this idea and maybe be a little protective, but then through the community, actually have it become something that's truly viable versus an idea held by one person.
Yeah. We kind of, again, you know, we're a community workshop again. So if you do have that thing that you don't want to talk about, probably not best to even come in the doors yet. But we've had people that are kind of, I've been trying to do this on my own for so long, I've got a design patent on it, I'm trying to do it. And we at least discuss it. We've had people come in that don't even bring in a picture or an idea, just say some of the challenges they have. And we try to open our eyes to a little bit more of just getting this out there. The important thing is that once you do have that golden widget and ready, and maybe it's protected, that we can help you with launching it and getting it out, but not just with the launch and the PR and the marketing, but maybe we help you think about a different way. Maybe that golden widget needs this little modification, and now when you go, or maybe it works with this product better. I had a similar discussion with John just yesterday morning, but things like that, where people pitch ideas and just go, here's what we're thinking about. I was like, well, have you thought about this? If you had this one thing to talk about. But it, again, it's kind of organically, again, nothing formal yet, but it's happening at that makerspace now every day. I see it. Some of my members coming out to do a challenge or brought in a visitor, or brought in a friend. It's like, here's what he's thinking about. And it's neat and exciting to see that already.
You want to talk a little bit about better mousecraft and how that sort of evolved in terms of brainstorming ideas?
That was one thing that we're going to bring back, which was just a product idea design exercise we had. There was this contest called the IPSO Challenge. I think it's formalizing going on right now again this year, but we were kind of loosely invited. One of the organizers here at Colorado Springs and said, hey, we got this challenge coming up, and IPSO was Internet Protocol for Smart Objects, so Internet of Things you guys have been all hearing about. It's a design challenge around that, and you have to work with certain hardware that these sponsors provided. So we're like, let's have a little design exercise, lean coffee exercise. Let's see what comes out of our meeting. We had 10 people in that meeting. We ended up with a bunch of ideas at the end of the night, and of those, we pitched 3 to IPSO, and we ended up being national finalists in those 3 that we pitched, all out of the makerspace, all out of one night. One of them went, which was literally a better mousetrap, making dumb mousetraps smart. So add-on module to these dumb mousetraps, going the commercial route. That leapfrogged was one of the finalists. It was a worldwide challenge of people from Sweden, Iran, Germany, a couple from California, and 3 from Makerspace, which is kind of cool. Those are things we want to bring back. We're a little still busy with building out our space and getting all our tools ready that we have, that we're working on, and have that ready to members. But once we get that going this winter, we're going to start bringing back those design ideas challenge, because that was fun. That was really neat. I didn't think that would happen out of that one night. It was pretty exciting to see. When you get some of these ideas and minds in together in one room and kind of pitch it, and it kind of segues to startup weekend too. That has been going around. Ours is a little smaller, loose version. We're trying to do it around what we have in the makerspace, but startup weekend is really neat. I'm mentoring on that too. So it's kind of grown up the 3rd year doing that here.
Third year.
Yeah, so really exciting on that.
We're trying to break 50 people.
Yeah, and to circle back real quick, one thing that I hope that we get at the makerspace, we're kind of that resource and more of a formal resource for things like startup week or startup weekend. When you have that idea of that, can we prototype this out? I've been mentoring at previous startup weekends. Things like, didn't LotSpot go through on the startup weekends? So they were talking about not just software, but maybe a hardware device. I would love to go, okay, let's go today, Saturday, let's go over to Makerspace, let's try to prototype it out. And we want to have that here soon.
I'm gonna really date myself here, but you sound kind of like Junior Achievement grows up. And I wondered if you have a junior's program. I mean, I've grown up since, so all these kids that have just amazing ideas and brains, because they're not limited by some of us old farts, you know, and some stuff. So to direct a kid to you to do something, do you have that kind of space for them as well?
We don't right now. We do through a couple of our members, our another family membership, and get their brilliant kid in there, and it's been pretty neat. Matthew, who was in that IPSO challenge, he was actually part of the team and going through. And he's still around the makerspace. He now has his license. He's an informal member because we have to be 18 and over. But he comes in with his father when he comes in, and it's really neat to see that. But we don't have any programs yet. We do not have the people to support that. That's the biggest thing we don't have right now. So if folks come in the makerspace, and you have this little young 10-year-old entrepreneur, right now we're kind of referring them to the library of the makerspace over there. They have a little more. They have channels in place and things like that, a little bit more set up for the younger makers than we do right now.
Is that something you're maybe looking forward to in the future, possibly?
Absolutely. Absolutely. Yep.
Kids have been curing cancer.
Yeah.
You had talked about a business that has a product that isn't a business yet. One of the things I kind of worry about that is liability. What if you inadvertently infringe on someone, or someone gets hurt, and you're not to a place where you have product liability insurance? Do you have kind of any kind of covering for someone who's wanting to stay protected but doesn't have an entity or liability insurance. What
so
do you do?
It is, yeah, the lampshade's not too worried about its liability on that one. But if that comes in, we've already discussed some of our channels that, right, do we kind of call this a fork traction tractor kind of thing and have that protection, that umbrella protection under traction tractor, and that's something we want to have in place soon.
Wow.
Yeah.
What's your greatest success story? I just
want to
remember so far.
we don't have one of those finally yet. We're so new. I mean, we're barely over, we're not even 2 years old, barely over that with the Makerspace and Journal, both locations. So we're, those success stories are still being written right now. So we have probably about five, I know, pretty steady entrepreneurs are going through and having that new thing, but even a success story like him, even if we get him selling a little bit more, I call that a success. But we don't have that, you know, big thing that's made the national news and that news yet, but I know we will. So.
All right.
Thanks.
One more.
Do you have hours when people can come in and just get tours so that you don't have to accept separate appointments for every person that I refer to?
We're not quite open house ready right now, but we're going to get the monthly open houses going back. This winter, we're probably going to have bi-monthly open houses. So you put everything on meetup.com. You also see it on our Facebook page and our main page. You see our schedule on there, but meetups are kind of go-to point for launching and doing these events we have. Let me open houses. We just open the doors, come on in, check out, see what we're doing. We'll do them for both locations this winter.
You know the drill. You definitely know it. One last question, special question. Somebody please raise their hand.
Kathy!
Yes! What can we as a community do to support you?
Thank you for asking that question. I think right now it's just awareness. Let people know that there's this resource out there. You probably know someone who's, or maybe it's you, has had that little idea, or maybe that little product idea have been stewing around in your head, or your cousin, your uncle here locally. Let them know about this. Let them know we're looking for candidates, we're looking for new members. So just keep talking about us, talk about this idea. We're gonna start promoting and marketing this more and more. Once Kim gets all the way through kind of more established, we're gonna start launching and talking about this more. So that's all I ask, just keep talking about it.
I think we can do that.
Yeah.
All right, hey. Hey, thanks for coming today, y'all. We really appreciate you being here. Hope you enjoy it. Our presenters were Sol over there. Startup Weekend with Sam. Go see him. Sign up for that. You know, stay around. Feel free to chat. If there's coffee left, drink that up. But thanks for coming. We'll see you next week.
Woo!